everyone. Here we are again. Welcome back. Great session lined up for us. We're going to look into building 3D visualizations using Power Map. And I'm actually very lucky and happy to have Ari Shore here next to me because he's been one of our technical product marketing managers that's been driving Power Map and has been involved with a lot of the demos that were run at major events and so on. I think Ari is also one of the best hires we ever had at Microsoft. So with that, Ari, how about you kick it off and tell us a little bit about yourself, and then we'll drill into Power Map, right?
Sure. Thanks, Dandy. I don't know about being the best, but you know, I try my best being here for just 1.5 years at Microsoft. I graduated from the University of Michigan out of the business school there, and have since been the technical product marketing manager on Excel and self-service BI. So really getting to focus on some of the things like Power Map that are coming to Excel, and really redoing all the older visualizations that we had there, making them new again. So what you'll see today with Power Map is really an interactive, immersive experience within a map environment. So if you look here, when we think about Power Map in terms of, you know, what are the different pieces of Excel and Power BI, it's really within the visualization aspect. So that's what Sandy showed you in the last session was Power View and, you know, really interactive reports, dashboards. And now with Power Map, being able to have an immersive experience specifically with geospatial and temporal data. So just to take a little bit of a step back on, you know, where did this Power Map thing come from? It really came from Microsoft Research. And so there was a researcher there named Curtis Wong who was, as a young child in Los Angeles, not being able to really see the stars. He dreamed of visualizing the universe and all of the planets, stars, everything that was there. And that's really big data. Really big data at its finest, you know, all the uncertainty of space being able to be visualized. But aside from being able to visualize the universe, which he was able to do with Worldwide Telescope, he dreamt of making it a business intelligence tool and something that you could visualize the world, the planet Earth, so basically turn that camera around and be able to look at what is the big data that we look at every day as a business analyst, as a sales or marketing professional, finance person. And so that was his dream of taking Power Map from its Worldwide Telescope beginnings and bringing it into Excel as a really easy to use visualization tool on maps. So that's kind of what his dream was. And what you see here in the images are different types of visualizations that were kind of prototyped in Worldwide Telescope, some of which have then been brought forward into what used to be project codenamed GeoFlow and is now Power Map for Excel. So you can see there's, you know, regions, charts, paths, heat maps, and some of those you'll see today as we demo Power Map. So when we think about Power Map in terms of, you know, what are the different steps that you go through in order to create a Power Map visualization? Really all starts in Excel and the different types of data that you have in Excel. So for us looking at Excel and Power BI, we're really looking at, you know, bringing data in with Power Query from different sources, connecting to those data sources, refreshing those data sources, and bringing them into the Power Pivot data model. That's really where all the magic happens with Power View, as Sandy showed you, as well as Power Map. So what you see, you know, in the visualization on the left-hand side is a heat map of data that has been brought in using Power Query. And so what you're then able to do is send that data off to Bing. They geocode it on the Bing map for you. And what you'll see in the demo is you're able to then interact with it with different types of visualizations. So we have a number of different visualizations baked into Power Map. They are heat map, 3D columns, regions, as well as bubble pie charts. So, and you can do a different combination of them, create different layers. And that's really a key benefit of Power Map over other visualizations is the ability to really layer on different types of data. You know, the second phase is really discovery of insight and that immersive experience within the Power Map environment. So being able to take your data, your layers that you've created on the Bing map, and be able to play it over time. So if you have any kind of date, time column within your data, you can then play those points over time. Then you can annotate points. So what you'll see today is you can take annotations on metadata that you have within your table, or it could be an image that you pulled down from Bing. Any of those things can be used to really help tell your story within Power Map. You know, and then you're able to capture scenes. So it'll help when I kind of show this to you, but scenes are kind of like slides in a larger PowerPoint deck. So like I'm showing you here, I have a slide on visualization and storytelling. We could have a scene that looks at one particular geography and calls out a specific insight in that geography. So that's the type of things that you can do in terms of discovery of insights. But the end goal of Power Map is really to be able to share the stories that you create in Power Map. So being able to take those scenes, combine some cinematic elements, maybe zooming in or flying over or doing a figure eight, and then be able to weave them together with those effects. So that's really what creates that cinematic story, or what we call tours, that can then be shared broadly, either within the Excel workbook or with an export to video that we've recently added into Power Map. And so our goal is really to take those tours and make them as broadly available and as immersive as we can. Right now, it's kind of a desktop Excel tool, but the next rev is really seeing it be an exploration experience across devices, across browsers, all of those different things. So what I'll do is jump right into the demo, and what we have here, if I open up my Excel workbook, is New York City 311 data. And so for those of you who don't know, 311 data is really looking at the non-emergency municipal service calls throughout a specific geography. So in this case, New York City, and looking at what types of complaints come in. So we aren't looking at violent crimes or anything like that, but it's interesting to see the trends of where complaints come in. And the reason why we really wanted to look at this, Dandy, was because Super Bowl happened, right?
And yeah, so we worked on this data set together, and one of the things that this data set actually shows is this is really accessible to you. It's just a combination of using Power Query to retrieve that data from a public API, which is the New York City open data set that you could use. Mm-hmm. So what you can do with that is you can bring that data into Excel, mm-hmm. and then we map that out because you see that a lot of governments, a lot of cities actually publish that level of data. And there's, in my opinion, no data set so rich as what we discovered when we drilled down and visualized some of that New York City data. So we were kind of interested. It's like, hey, New York City is hosting the Super Bowl, us all being Seattle Seahawks fans.
Go Hawks.
For obvious reasons, right? We were kind of wondered on, hey, what is the impact on the 311 citizen service in relationship to the Super Bowl? Are there any trends or patterns that we can discover? And you can really go as rich as far as you want with this. So what we basically did is we looked at the data since the beginning of January, but actually New York City publishes that data since the beginning of 2010. So basically you could grab this data set, bring that into Power Query, and bring that into data discovery and visualization with some really amazing capabilities that we have sitting on top of that data set. So that's the idea. That's how we got there. And so we worked together with Ari and team to bring that into Power Map. We worked with the Power View team to bring that into Power View. And then we also enabled Q&A on that and actually made that part of our demos that we ran at press announcements and press briefings as we did them prior to GA announcement of Power BI yesterday.
So. Yeah, that's great context, Andy. And yeah, it really helps tee up what you're going to see here with Power Map. So what we look at here, this is a Super Bowl report, a Power View like what Sandy showed you in the last session, and really being able to drill into different issues, so being able to look at snow as an issue and kind of how that changed over the span of Super Bowl Sunday. You can see later in the evening when the game was going on, not many snow complaints.
Can we click on those reported calls real quick?
Yeah.
Because what I think that was stunning is, the other tab, the reported calls report.
Oh, yeah, sure. Uh-huh. Yeah, let's go over this.
So what I think is interesting on this one, if we look in some of the categories, is we can actually filter those by borrow. Mm. There is a category called snow, and this is the cross-linking that Sandy was showing. If I filter on snow, what we actually see that in the spike on the right is, hey, New York actually was really hit by a couple of snow days since the beginning of January.
The polar vortex, that, right?
You just see that, yeah, the polar vortex. And you just see that spiking out in terms of the number of complaints and so on.
Yeah.
And just being able to grab that data set, we're talking about over 200,000 calls since the beginning of January, and just pull that in, bring that into visualization, I think is a key strength of Power BI and with all the visualizations in place, right?
Yeah, and you can actually see just on the right-hand side those Power Query queries that we brought in, you know, looking at that actual data that we brought in and connected to an open data source like New York City 311.
Yeah, and then one of the other things we did is actually we could pull things in from a live API. So we used another API, and we'll share that information on a blog as well, on how we can collect the actual current weather in New York and then relate that back to the last 1,000 calls that were published and see if there's a relationship or a correlation between weather and that data. So right. So that's the context around the data set, right?
We spent a lot of time on the data set.
It's an amazing data set.
Oh, it really is. And you'll really see it light up as I show you some of the Power Map stuff. So definitely helpful context there. So if we look at, Borrow Report, this is a Power View again. We can start, seeing things geospatially. So looking at, Queens, New York, and being able to filter that. We can, play it over time, which is great. We see Queens and we see, is this Brooklyn here, kind of duking it out. Yeah, Brooklyn is the other dot there, duking it out over time. But really, if we think about it, this doesn't allow us to get the really immersive insights into our geospatial data, say if we have latitude, longitude data, rather than just by borough. So that is where Power Map comes in and incorporates the geospatial data and the temporal data that you see on this timeline into a really immersive experience and presentation experience. So if we go here, you can see Power Views there on the Insert tab of Excel, but then we can also go in and you see Power Map. And so we'll launch Power Map. And what we have is, two different tours, and those are the kind of the final presentation, as I mentioned before, of Power Map. So I see one, Build It, New York City 311. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to jump into that, and I'm going to show you how to build one of these Power Maps just using the data that you already have in Excel. So what we can do here is, we have our introductory slide of 311 calls, kind of tease up what that data set is. So think about it much like you would have a PowerPoint presentation with your introductory slide. And then, that second slide is really where we start wanting to add our data. And so that's what we're going to do here. So if we, just to kind of orient yourself with the Power Map UI, it helps for a second to step back and do that. We can see on the right-hand side, we have the scenes. In the middle, we have the map itself. And then on the right-hand side, we have our field well. And the field well is much like the field well you would see in Power View or a pivot table. So it shouldn't disorient you too much to know that that's where you do a lot of your selection of data. So what we'll do is actually we'll add a layer. And as I mentioned before, layers are really where you start creating the data on the map. So if we add a layer, what we see is we're prompted in the right-hand corner for geography and map level. So what we need to do is select that data in the right-hand column. So luckily, we have latitude, longitude. We can just check those. And immediately, we see all of those data points show up on the map. Really amazing to see how quickly Bing is able to geocode the values. And if you have a touchscreen like I do here, it's amazing to be able to just, pinch and zoom in. And so I can move around. I can see that data. I can add map labels. I can even change the theme a little bit to get a little bit of greenery. Since we're in the Northwest, we got to see our trees. And so then what we'll do is I'll call out here that there's different types of geospatial characteristics that you can use. So you could use latitude, longitude. In this case, it actually recognized that I had latitude, longitude selected and immediately mapped it for me. Then there's also city, country, region, county, state, street, zip, and address. An interesting fact is this other column right here, that's actually an all-encompassing term. So if you have like city and state, you can use other in order to pick up on that and geocode the values on the map. So we've also tried things like names of universities, names of businesses, and a lot of times those will show up on the map as well.
So question on that one, is that the other category there? Would that be something that anything that the Bing API can map?
Yep. Italy.
So
exactly, Danny.
When I look into airport codes, which is a very unique code for each of the airports, mm-hmm. I could just map that based on the airport code without needing a physical address or without needing, to that perspective, any zip code or whatsoever, right?
Yeah, that's absolutely true. And if you end up trying it and something doesn't map, definitely let us know because the team is continuously working on improving the geo-accuracy of the Bing mapping service. So definitely definitely try it with your own data and see what's able to show up. You know, what will happen sometimes is there will be points that aren't geocoded, but you're made aware of that. So that you can kind of act on it, maybe change the data, add a column to clarify. And actually, I'll do that in just a few minutes so you can see what I'm talking about.
Yeah, one of the things that I've done is from a mapping perspective is really try out on how this does internationally. Like, hey, going back to my home country, what about
Where are you from, Danny?
Belgium.
Belgium.
Yeah. So mapping the actual Belgian postal codes, which is a totally different mechanism than U.S. or Netherlands or Australia to that perspective. And, I mean, I've been presenting this in Australia, in back in Europe. I was just surprised by the accuracy in terms of mapping and the mapping capabilities based on any of the columns that you might have and allow you to drill down on things like region, zip code, county. I mean, it's just phenomenal.
And it really should be all-encompassing in terms of allowing you to map whatever data you have, no matter where you are. I mean, the big exception being, you know, U.S. embargoed countries don't usually give us all of that data. But other than that, you're in pretty good hands to know that your data can be mapped in PowerMap. So let's just continue a little bit. Once we have our data geocoded, it's really all about just selecting what data in our tables in either Excel or the Power Pivot data model we want to actually put on the map. So in this case, we can just look at, you know, the calls. The call volume shows up. We can, you know, exit out of that. And you can see that immediately we get some insights. You know, we're seeing where the calls are coming from over the span of January. And so we can just, you know, mouse over and see, hey, look, at this particular latitude, longitude, there's a lot of calls there. So if we want to learn more about that, we can start adding data that has category values. So in this case, looking at complaint category, like we saw in the power view, we're able to then see, hey, you know, this is construction complaints. It's probably a specific building or neighborhood that's having some issues. And, you know, if we want to, we can just zoom right into that.
Might be a neighbor that's having some issues.
That's no good. Here, we can, you know, pivot around. Zoom in there. And what's great is, you know, once you're zoomed in, you know, you can click on it to learn more. We can, you know, if we want to be able to see some of the underlying map, we can change the layers, you know, change the height a little bit, change the thickness. And so then what happens is you're able to then zoom in a lot and really get more and more detail just using Bing Maps.
Oh, that actually two buildings next to each other. Okay.
Yeah, so pretty interesting to see that take place. And then let's zoom out a second. What we can do is then add some more value to this particular power map by allowing us to play it over time. So if we just click date time, and I'll scroll down a little bit in my field well, you'll see that a time play axis will show up on the bottom. And what that allows me to do is play this data over time, over the span of January. So if I just click play, we start seeing all these complaints pop up. And what you can also do is customize how it shows up in the time play. You know, you can show it by, you know, show it for an instant, show it accumulate, or show it until it's replaced to maybe see some seasonality of, you know, when are this peak times when it's actually coming in, rather than just an accumulation. You know, and you can also change the type of the way that it's actually presented, the date time. So we can go edit, and, you know, we could change it to maybe just be, you know, the day of the week as well. We can accept that, you know, put it in our text box here, and then be able to play it in the same way. What we'll then do is, you know, I'll show you some of the other visualizations that you can use within Power Map. So, like, if we're looking at, you know, how are the call volumes really taking place by borough, kind of like what we saw in the Power View, but taking it to that next level, we can start doing that as well. So we'll add another layer looking at borough as a county. And you see the boroughs pop up there. Just hit next, add the call volumes. And immediately we can see, oh, we got Queens taking the lead, as we saw actually in the Power View as well. We can change it to a region map. And so this is actually a recent add to Power Map of being able to do regions or chloropleth maps and have kind of a scale of a volume of calls here. We could then add another layer. So say we want to look a little bit deeper at those particular boroughs, we can go to go to look at latitude, longitude again, and then select the specific call volume, but this time as a heat map. And what's great there is, you know, we're able to see it over time. We can see here with adding our, it's at our date time actually. And we can start adding that seasonality I was talking about. And we can see over time where in the different boroughs we're getting the highest call volume. So you see over here, that's probably that construction area we were talking about. But what's going on over here? There's some interesting stuff there. You know, we could switch it back to a column chart, give us a little bit more info. We could get the, you know, switch it to no longer be about just the calls, but also about the category. So we can see, you know, noise complaints happening over there. So wonder what's happening there. So if we take a even smaller view at that in terms of a particular time, this being Super Bowl Sunday, we can do just that. So we can, you know, look at adding a layer specifically for Super Bowl Sunday. And so we'll do latitude, longitude again. Since you have such a granular geospatial capability, You can look at that. So what we'll do is add our Super Bowl Sunday calls. And you see those pop up, specifically in Manhattan. And we can change it to be time as well, date time. And so one important thing to mention here is that we have some sort of filtering in Power Map, but not as much as we have in Power View. Mm-hmm. That's something that we really know is an ask by many customers. But right now, we can do some filtering in terms of time. So if we want to look at, make sure it's just giving me Super Bowl Sunday, we can just go over here into the settings, the scene settings, and filter it by Super Bowl Sunday. And we could change the timing of it. Be just on, you know, right now it was about 7 o'clock that we had the games, or 7 p.m. that we had the game start, so we can change that. And ended around 10 p.m., right? And so then what we can do is play it over time, and you'll see some of the calls pop up as the game is going, but not very many, which tells us, you know, hey, not very many calls are happening during this time of the game. Most people are really watching. And then, you know, if we wanted to, we could get a descriptor value as well, see what types of complaints are actually happening, you know, like a blocked hydrant. So let's actually see as we play it over time, we can see those particular ones pop up. Oh, a lot, some of the green, you know, what is this particular one? Get some more info. So we could like add an annotation to that to make sure that in our end tour we're able to know what was actually happening there. So, you know, we could add our date time, 9 p.m. there was a commercial overnight parking complaint. So probably someone watching the game, right? Probably a good bet.
Yeah.
And so, you know, we've also created a, we've created one here with category and looking specifically at one data point. You can see you can add image annotations as well. So that's kind of a nice ability. Aside from adding just data, you can add an image annotation like we have here, and you can see the Seahawks and the Broncos fans, some kind of loud music party going on after the game. So if you want to tell a story like that, Power Map is really your tool. And so what we can do is kind of our end game for Power Map is being able to play that tour over time. So what you can
do,
see.
Do we want to take off that title real quick so we can kind of just show that the title seems to be like overlaying a lot of the visualization.
Oh, and actually on the big screen here, it shouldn't show up. And we can actually move it within the Power Map tour if we want to.
Yeah. I'll show
you. So here's the complaint volumes. And what you can see is we have some cinematic elements woven in here. You know, and that's being able to, in the scene options, just select what type of cinematic effect we want on that scene.
So now, you're playing a tour here. That means I can still interact with that data as
it's
I'm playing
the tour,
It's
a great point,
right?
Dandy. Yeah, so if I just click and then, you know, zoom in with my fingers here, I'm able to have that same interactivity. It pauses my tour. You know, I can even move around some of the, some of these visualizations. Actually, made it a little bigger there. We can keep playing it. So this is still an interactive experience, and that's important to call out. You know, this isn't just a video. Although we can create videos out of these Power Map tours, it's also interactive within the Excel experience.
Uh-huh.
And so we imagine this type of interactive experience being able to be, you know, within the Excel worksheet, maybe within different Office applications like a PowerPoint presentation, really being able to interact with it on a mobile device. You know, those types of scenarios are things that we're really looking at. Would love feedback on the places that you see these tours ending up.
Yeah, so one of the things that I use is on my Windows phone, I got this application that is called GPS Track Recorder.
Oh, that's right.
It actually, it's written by one of our Microsoft PMs, right? I mean, can you just imagine on the capabilities you have there? It's like, let's say we all use that application. Is I know at any point in time where one of my drivers, if I'm like, let's say, in a general contractor or whatever, I know exactly where each of my drivers are in the city, and then I could pull in that New York City data and filter and say, like, hey, show me all the buildings that have heating issues, and then just call my driver and say, hey, would you mind stopping by that building? There seems to be like 150 heating complaints last day. Maybe we can generate some business there. So there's quite some business opportunities in being able to leverage those great visualizations with the discoverability of open data sets and things that I have sitting within my own system. Now, you've seen a tour, but I've been...
Yeah, he's shown some... some amazing tours, actually, that Dandy creates in his off time.
One of the things I've done, which is quite interesting, is like, hey, you know what? You got family visiting, and you take them around on a tour. I was constantly tracking our GPS position. Mm-hmm. So afterwards, I can actually send them a video, the exported video from my Power Map, and then just go in and just edit that, put the little background music to it. The annotations with the images and such are just great. You can reflect over time, really build a story around. And that's what I think Power Map is just amazing in terms of being able to story tell your data and run your presentations that way. So, yeah, I think that's a great capability right
there. Yeah, visualization and storytelling and geospatial and temporal data, if you could think about it in terms of two things, those are the pair that you would want to think about with Power Map. And so, as Dandy said, you can create these videos, presentation ready for HD displays like this one, for computers and tablets. I always recommend using the highest res. It shrinks down some of the annotations and the text boxes when it does that, because it optimizes it for the large screen. So just keep that in mind when you're creating your annotations and your text boxes. But really great. I mean, if you go on YouTube and just search Power Map tour, you'll find tons and tons of tours that other people have created in just this way of with their own data, with public data sets.
And we also had the Power BI contest that many people actually joined into. Submitted their videos, which is we did a Power BI contest on the preview bits for people actually to discover and use Power BI. We've seen some amazing demos from all across the globe. people drilling into that. I think we selected the 10 finalists
the winners.
Recently.
Yeah, yeah.
So yeah, these guys will be featured as well. So there's quite some capabilities there in terms of bringing that data to life.
Yeah. Before we wrap up, I really want to show you how easy it is to bring data into Power Map, because I've showed you kind of some data that we already prepped a little bit.
Yeah.
But I want you to understand how easy it is for us to just grab data using Power Query and then put it right into Power Map.
Yeah, what you haven't really shown us yet is like, hey, I'm going to start from something totally blank, nothing.
Let's just add a sheet, right? And then go to online search. And I know you guys have already heard a little bit about Power Query today, right?
So we had a great session
that Matt Mason
presented.
He's excellent. He's really excellent. Yeah, so what I can do here is, you know, if I'm looking for, income for New York City. Actually, my search was saved here, but you'll see it search again and pull in this particular income population demographics of New York City. Looks pretty good to me. There's a few things I might need to touch up with this data set to be able to visualize in Power Map. So luckily, Power Query has that capability of being able to do some transformations on the data. So we'll just jump right into Power Query. And what we can do is, you know, change this particular column, get rid of that percentage so we can just replace the value. So if we go percentage sign, enter. We can change these to numbers so that they'll be picked up in Power Map and in other visualizations. We can change this to county so that it'll also be picked up by the Power Map Bing service. And so what we have now is actually pretty much what we'll need to be able to map it. We can also, you know, add a column to make it even easier to map it in Power Map. So if we just insert a custom column, we could just have it equal to New York.
Oop. You want to put that between quotes.
Oh, you're right. Yeah. That's a good point. Just delete that. Clearly not as much of a Power Query expert as Matt Mason, huh? He's excellent. So we'll do, between quotes, New York.
Or just put it in a stacks, basically. I don't think you need to put any equals there.
Oh, right. Like that?
Uh-huh.
And there we go. So now we can just call this state. Can move that over. And now we're pretty much in a place where we can start visualizing it. We could load it. We won't load it to the data model, because actually what I want to show you is Power Map will load it for you into the data model when we select it. So we have here, we have our data brought in with Power Query very quickly, and we can just go insert Power Map, add the selected data to the Power Map, and that's because I have the Power Map window already open. It recognizes that I'm authoring a tour and want to add some more data to it. And so you'll see it actually just added it to the Power Pivot data model, and our regions show up there, except for United States and some of the ones that weren't necessarily boroughs. And you can see that county and state are automatically recognized from that data set because we labeled them as such. Of course, if you have your columns labeled something else, you can just select that from the dropdown as well. So what we can do is then just start visualizing that data we have within Power Query and then within Excel. So we just start selecting it. We start seeing the median and mean household incomes.
Put that as a clustered.
Clustered. Yeah, it's true. You can see them next to each other. We could look at, adding a new layer that's just percentage in poverty. So, add that same county and state. Add our percent in poverty. Because you don't want it comparing specifically. Maybe we make that as a bubble chart. And so then,
so you could also name each of those layers, right?
That's a good point. Yeah, so we could label this, percent in poverty. And that will stay with it, when in our layer. So these are all of our layers on this particular map. You see we have a lot of them. We've added a few of them. And then this is the one, percent in poverty, that we just added.
Can you resize that title as well? I still feel like
It's pretty big. Yeah, I think you're right. It's a little big. Yeah. So we can, maybe we'll just, we'll get rid of that subtitle there. We can move this up there with the time. And so that's a little bit better. And now what we can see is, you know, we can hide layers if we wanted to, you know, looking at maybe this percent in poverty we don't necessarily want to look at. Uh-huh. But we can see where the call volumes are taking place versus the income. It's interesting to see how we actually get a lot of calls in the areas of high income, right? We can, you know, change what we can change this heat map to be a little bit less dominating as well. So if we want to change the radius of influence, the color scale a little bit, we can do that. Oh, you know what? It was actually a layer that I just added. That's a good point. Let's see, I think it was. There we go. Wrong layer. Make sure you're always on the right layer so you can change it.
So. And then from a scenes perspective, one of the other things you could do as well is specify the transition time and the way to transition between scenes mm-hmm. as well, right?
It's a good point, yeah. So layer options is where we are now looking at the actual visualization, but scene options is really where we do the time filtering as well as the different effects that you saw there, like dolly, flyover, push-in. Uh-huh. The default is station, so it'll just, you know, transition between one and the other with a flyby and then stop at that destination. But if you want any kind of effect after you get to that location, you'd want to use these right here. And then you can, you know, change the duration of the scenes and how long the transition takes place
yeah.
for.
And then turn it from a globe into a flat map as well.
Oh, that's a good point. Yeah, so you can, you know, you can change. It actually helps to have the full effect of the globe as it is now and then change it to a flat map. What's really cool is, you know, if you go from a globe like this to a flat map, play the tour, you'll see the whoosh that you see in the authoring experience also in the tour. Really good way to kind of add some impact to your mm-hmm. Power Map tours.
Oh, wow. Yeah.
That's well, just... wait for it. It hasn't happened yet. Oh.
There
we go. It flattens
out. Nice.
So, yeah, those are that's most of the stuff that you can do with Power Map right now as it nears GA. I will say that you can also add a 2D chart if you wanted to, you know, use kind of a find functionality in this one, actually, since I didn't. There we go. Add my layer there. This actually has it by latitude, longitude, which doesn't tell us quite as much. Mm-hmm. But what you can do is, you know, if you click on one particular point, that allows us to zoom to that particular location. So you can see that the other ones are kind of grayed out, but we're able to identify that particular point.
And it could also filter by category, it seems.
Yep. Okay. Yep. It can be different categories. Yep. Uh-huh. So a little bit of stuff that you can do with the 2D charts, but again, you know, what you saw with PowerView, what you see with PowerMap, ideally we bring those together, have a filtering experience, have an experience where you can really uh-huh. Create one visualization that allows you to identify insights, whether it's geospatial or by category, by value, whatever you'd like. Yeah.
And then, yeah, one of the last features there was like, hey, now I can go export this to a video. Mm-hmm. It'll render a video. I can put some music to it, and ta-da, mm-hmm. we're ready.
Uh-huh. Yeah, exactly. So we'll jump back here, just so we can wrap up a little bit. And so really, I always like to conclude with this slide because it really speaks to the vision of PowerMap and being able to transform that data that you have in Excel into 3D stories. So that's what you saw here, is taking that data, whether it was already in Excel, whether it was brought in with Power Query, and transforming it into that really immersive experience. And so that's the goal with PowerMap. That's the goal with a lot of our visualizations going forward as we kind of go to this new era of Power BI, making the Excel experience much richer and being able to then share those visualizations out with everyone within your organization.
So one of the questions asked on the forum was, it's quite an interesting question. Mm. What's the maximum number of records that could be mapped at one time?
Ooh, that's a good question. We get that question a lot.
What's your biggest amount of records to map?
We've done 23 million records.
Okay, you beat me.
Yeah, 23 million. And actually, it was looking at internet speed across different geographies. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, many different data points very close together, yeah. like different IP addresses, looking at that internet speed. So you can do a lot of data points, and it's really a matter of how much memory you have on your computer, what kind
of processing
your video card, all those all those things, graphics card, yeah. So being able to, you know, kind of take into account those limitations. Running 64-bit Excel also helps for processing large volumes, as I think was probably mentioned in one of the other sessions of, you know, whatever you have in PowerPivot, you know, it uses up your memory pretty quickly. So having 64-bit really helps.
Yeah, so one of the things I've done is based with this data set is I actually pulled in the 2010 up till the most recent data set. So we're looking at 6 million calls on the city of New York, and I actually created a power map video out of that because the rendering does take a while and you wouldn't want to present this in this session. Yeah. Another great implementation and usage case that I've seen, and we have that as part of our demo set, and actually there's also a case study, is the folks you've been involved with, our Microsoft Digital Crime Lab.
The Crime Lab, yeah, they love Power Map.
That did some great visualization on, in terms of product activation, related issues, and so
piracy,
on.
Piracy, yeah. Big problem
some
these
really
days.
Really great things.
Yeah, that's crime fighting with Power Map. Pretty cool story right there, and all new for Microsoft. So very cool things that people are doing with Power Map, and we love to see the things you're doing. You know, send us your YouTube videos of your Power Maps, your files. Love to see them. It's really helping us rethink how we develop the product as well.
Okay, with that, I want to thank you for your time. We're going to be back in about 10 to 15 minutes. Ari, thanks for being here.
Thank
you,
always,
Andy. Great pleasure being on stage with you. This time, not into a shark uniform as last time, but still enjoying it. Okay, thanks everyone. We'll be back.